about to blow. I gotta stay on my hustle, you know that I'm grinding for sure. I came out right from the bottom, now they see me chasing my goals. Now they see me on the go, now they see me on the road. It's time to hustle, yeah, it's time to grow. I'ma shoot for the stars and we ain't for the gold. It's time to hustle, yeah, it's time to grow.
Yo, what's up? Welcome back to Hustlers. I'm your host, Loss. I've got my man on today, Big Ram.
What's up, brother?
What's up, bro?
Thanks for coming, G.
Always a pleasure.
What's been doing?
Not a whole lot. Just got back up from Christchurch. Back up here for a wee bit of time now.
Back to Hams, what? Monday?
Oh, for a week. Back to Hams.
What's the go there? Like, what do you got to do?
Nah, it's just like a get in, get some training done before pre-season actually starts. It's a good chance to, make sure you're tracking right before that first Bronco.
Who has to go in then?
Oh, it's kind of varied. Like, it's not like a specific. Oh, that was probably more specific people as opposed to the whole team. I'm kind of going in just to make sure that I picked up a little niggle at the end of Mitre 10 or Bunnings.
All right, yep.
Go in to make sure that that's all good and should be all good.
You got a Bronco or?
I hope not. I don't think
surely,
so.
Surely, bro.
The hopes are high that we don't. I think the Broncos, January the 6th, is the first Bronco.
There's no way that's the first Bronco. You're getting slapped with one on Monday, I guarantee it.
No.
What's a midfield Bronco test like? What's your target like you're supposed to hit at Chiefs?
I wouldn't even have a clue, eh? Like, they don't
exactly. They don't really have like a,
give you
a try at this?
Nah. It's more just a, once you finish it and if it's not up to standard, then Batman's club.
What would you call up to standard? Under five?
Oh, yeah.
That's up to standard.
Yeah, it definitely has to be under five.
Yeah.
If you're over five, I'd say you'd be in a bit of trouble.
I'm going to make a shout out to the sponsor of the podcast, Arepa. Got one here and we've got the new fridge. Yeah, make a quick switch camera to there. Show that beautiful fridge going on here. It's a Friday arvo, so we're actually having a few beers today, but it's a brain drink made for mental clarity when you're stressed and fatigued. Guarantee, hands down, it works. I use it every day for work. It really helps me think. But like long night studying, instead of jumping on the old energy drinks, jump on one of these. Word on the streets, All Blacks are actually using it as well. And some big names that are wanting to kind of invest in the company now, so I've heard. So some big, big names, bro. So big things coming for Arepa. Shout out to Arepa for sponsoring. You get a free box for jumping on, G. So
true.
Get you on sense, try it out, see if it works. Use Hustlers20 promo code and you'll get 20% off online. Make sure you use that, helps the podcast out, helps us keep running. So bro, what's been happening lately? Tell me what's the latest.
To be honest, I've been on a bit of break since footage finished. Just been down in Christchurch chilling, training. Not a whole lot, to be honest, just enjoying my time off.
How good the boys don't have to do December preseason this year?
Huge fan of it, to be honest. The old preseasons are tough because, you know, you've got a hard slog before Christmas and then you get like a week and a half, 2 weeks maybe off over that Christmas and New Year's period.
2 weeks, yeah.
And you're back into getting slogged. But with the late finish of that Bunnings comp and then you don't actually have much time for that preseason. And then the preseason after January, it's only like 3 weeks before your first preseason game. So,
bro, that's a dream, bro.
Yeah.
Wasn't that shit around when I had to do it, man? If Bunnings finished when it was supposed to, would you guys?
Yeah, I think it would have gone back to normal.
Oh, really?
Would have been the
so it was just that COVID shit that's made this happen.
Yeah. Pretty much.
You almost get an AB's break, bro.
Pretty much.
How soon's that? Do you tell us a little bit about your upbringing and like where you grew up in that? Obviously, like Bev have known you for ages.
I can't remember.
Yeah, bro, what was the first time we played together? Was it under 11s?
Yeah, that Western Bay Plenty team.
Western Bay, yeah, under 11s. But about your upbringing, bro.
Pretty much lived in Papamoa my whole life up until for as long as I can remember. Ended up going to a little country school out in Pongakawa, which was a good 30-minute drive from home. Did 8 years of full primary there, and then from there, ended up going over to Hamilton Boys and did my whole 5 years boarding, which was good. during that time, I think the rents ended up moving out to Pukina, and currently still out there. So, but after school, ended up heading down to Christchurch, where I ended up studying and chasing the rugby dream, and currently still down there and for half the year, and then back up in Hamilton for the other half, which is all weird.
You fell in love a bit with the old Christchurch, eh?
Yeah, I do love that city. Like, it's not too big.
Heaps of the boys, like, pretty much everyone that goes down loves it, eh? Like, not even kidding. Braden, Enor, Big Tarms.
Yeah, I think a lot of that is to do with the rugby side of it as well. But the city itself, like, you're not too far from a beach, and it's still a city, but not too big. And after the earthquakes, like, everything's relatively new. But no, I do enjoy it down there. Like,
well, your home club, pretty prestigious, eh? The old club down there,
Lincoln Uni.
Yeah, is it
our club down there?
Rams.
Yeah, Lincoln Rams. It's actually quite a funny club because we're always so young. Like, obviously, it's like a rotation with when people come and go for uni, and usually in the team for 3 or 4, you've got the old ones that hang around. But I think teams hate playing us just because we are young, and they hate, like, I hate losing to younger people.
Yeah, true.
We probably lack a little bit of the physicality, but, like, we're a lot fitter and probably more skillful than others, just because a lot of it's to do with, like, you come through a scholarship program where you're actually gymming and training there, and a lot of the boys who go into the Crusaders Academy as well, which is...
So you get, like, a scholarship... They have, like, a scholarship program within the actual club itself?
Well, it's a university, yeah.
So you, like, not, like, scholarship and then you're gymming and stuff within Canterbury or whatever? You're gymming within the club?
With me, I got the scholarship out at Lincoln, but the academy stuff took priority.
Yeah, okay.
It's kind of like a joint thing, so I was in with the academy, but there's people who come down who get the scholarship, and then they're involved with, like, Lincoln.
Yeah, okay.
You gym throughout the week and do your testing and whatnot. Like, it's similar setup.
Bro, name, like, when you've had, because I know there's been some big names, bro, at the Rams, at Lincoln Uni. Name at one time, like, one of your teams, where your team, like, who was in it, like a star-studded team.
I won't name my team because I think it was a couple years before me, but I'm pretty sure some of the boys are telling me you've got Eddie and Adi and Jack Stratton, who are, like, two quality...
Super rugby halfbacks.
Yeah, super rugby halfbacks, essentially.
There's one on the bench.
Yeah, I think they used to go, like, 40 each, eh?
Bro.
Just because they're both hissing players. I think Brett Cameron at 10, Geordie Barrett at 12, I think. I'm not too sure if this was the same time, but Jack Goodhue played there. He would have been at 13. And you got the likes of Caleb Markney,
Gun,
fullback, Josh Mackay.
Bro, that's rigged, G, for a club team.
Yeah, it's pretty silly.
What about fours? You and big heifers during that time?
To be honest, I'm not too sure if they're at the same time, but you got the likes of, I think Dominic Bird went there.
Oh, yep. He's Canes now, eh?
Tom Sanders.
Oh, yeah.
He played a couple of games while I was there. He dominates club, eh?
Yeah.
But then the ones who are there now, like the likes of Cullen Grace.
True, yeah.
He was mean. Like, I had no idea who he was when he came to Lincoln.
Yeah.
This, like, white gingerhead boy, like, first year, no idea who he was. And he came and played a game for us. And I was like, oh, yeah, sweet. And then I remember in that game, one of the biggest runners from the other team, like, they got a penalty. They took a quick tap and he got, like, a 10-meter run up, ran it straight at Cullen Grace and got absolutely set down.
Bro, he's low-key, eh? Like, he doesn't look like he'd be a hissing rugby player, but...
Oh, bro, I'm not surprised he's an All Black.
How's he... Like, have you, like, kept in contact with him around, like, how he's feeling around sort of missing the group again? And
yeah, I'm actually quite close with him. Like,
yeah,
got a good relationship with him. And I think he's definitely disappointed about it, but he also knows that he could have been better in terms of coming back from pre-season. And,
oh, yeah, okay.
I guess that translated into his performance, which wasn't bad. Like, he's still carving up at Super Rugby. Especially in his position, he's got a lot of competition.
Because how old is he? 20 or 21 or something?
I'd say 21 or 22.
you know that you're in the right place when you're 21 or 22
with the All Black cap.
And yeah, and you're worrying about All Black selection.
He's unreal, bro. He's a good fella too.
That's mean. So going back to like back at school and that, I remember you made the first thing quite early, eh? Like, because at Ham Boys, they don't really pick like younger players that often, eh?
Oh, if you're good enough, they'll pick you.
Like, but not often, though, eh?
You've got to be like one of a kind. I think one of the only boys in our year to like consistently stay in that first 15 was Patrick McCurran. Mm. And he was, he's still hissing.
Yeah, yeah. What's he up to now?
Still down? No, he's back in Ham. He's playing for Fraser Tech.
Oh, yeah.
He's probably one of the best players in the club comp this year.
True.
Getting
a look in, or?
Well, I think he played a few preseason games for Waikato. But he was hissing. I made my debut that year, but it was like 3 minutes off the bench right at the end of the game. Eh?
I think I remember it. Did you play halfback?
Yeah.
I watched it, Jay. It was on TV.
I was a 10 at school and I ended up going on at halfback, yeah.
I remember that, bro. Right at the very end. Yeah. I remember seeing you. Old big Rams jump on at halfback.
Wasn't big at that stage. Holy.
You're still pretty big for like our age.
Nah.
Yeah. Well, maybe compared to me, that's not hard. When you went down, obviously, like, because we're all the same age group, we went to like 20s camps together in that. And like our last year, you missed out on that. But I remember that was that same year, eh, that you got that first sort of super cap, I guess, or first cap for the Crusaders.
Yeah, yeah. I've kind of had that, like, my whole, especially at that stage, like, missed out on schools and bar bars, but because of that, I got to play and captain the NZ Maori under-18s, which was the first year they had that, which
was
pretty special, and then ended up getting called up into the bar bars for that last game as well, so I kind of got the best of both worlds. And then, our 20s year, like, I guess everyone's goal is playing rugby at that stage. Like, obviously wants to make that team and missed out on that as well. Obviously it was gutted as, but I guess the silver lining to that was in that same year I got to, because the 20s boys were away, I think I got to have a couple of games for the Crusaders, which was surreal. Yeah, that was unreal.
Yeah, so you played that French Barbas team, eh? And then did you go to Aussie?
Yeah, it was a weird one. So it wasn't a Super Rugby game, but that French Barbas technically counted as a cap because it was technically an international game.
Right.
And it was just such a weird concept of how that came to. Like, wasn't expecting to play that at all.
Were you in with them, like, before that?
Yeah, so, like, Crusaders do it quite well where I guess everyone's quite close and it's easy to get boys in. So that, like, if you're in the academy and they need numbers, like,
stay young.
Yeah, and you look at it and kind of take it for granted, but it's an unreal experience doing that as a young boy, like going to train with the big dogs.
You don't see that much, eh? Like, well, I didn't really see that sort of stuff that often everywhere I've been, like wellies and that.
Mm.
Didn't really happen, like, not like that. Same as Hams, I don't think it really happens like that.
Yeah, I'm not too sure what it's like around the rest of the country. I don't think we do that to the same extent at Chiefs. But, I was pretty lucky to be training with the boys for a wee while. Like, you kind of get called in for certain days in and out.
Yeah.
And then I just remember that week, the All Blacks were away for the June Test Series and they have that Super Rugby window where there's a couple weeks off. And I think Ray's had organised some games just to keep the boys ticking over. And one of those games was the French Barbarians. And I remember sitting in there and they're like, we're just going to name the team. And I like genuinely was just, I was genuinely just sitting there like, it's just another training.
Yeah,
Didn't really care. And they put the team up and I was like, ended up getting named at 12. And I was like, like, my heart dropped and I was like,
because you were 19 at that time too, eh?
Yeah, I was 19, had missed out on 20s, like, hadn't played Mighty 10 Cup yet, and I was like, holy heck. And the buzziest thing about that was the guy inside me, Mullies, I think it was his last year of playing rugby.
Mullies.
like the concept of him having played with my old man when he was younger, and now I'm playing outside him in like a Crusaders jersey.
That's so cool.
It was like real buzzy.
And then you went to Aussie, you started that game too, eh?
Yeah, so I remember after that game, like I kind of just went out there. I was so nervous, bro, like kind of questioned whether I deserved to be there or not, and kind of, I don't know, I didn't have a terrible game. Like,
was this the first or second game?
The first one.
Oh, yeah.
I remember after the game, Ronan O'Gara, he was with one of the coaches at the time, absolutely, like one of the best coaches I've had, I reckon.
Yeah.
Just doesn't beat around the bush. And he's just like, oh, like, came up to me, congratulations, mate. Like, you know, you look fine out there. But if you get another chance, like, you make sure you put your mark on it. And I was like, holy, like.
Shit.
Anyway, like, get to the Sunday after that week and didn't know if I had to go into training or not. So I messaged the manager and I was like, oh, like, I don't want to not turn up and I'm supposed to be there. So I'd rather ask the question, like, am I supposed to be in training this week? He's like, oh, mate, I thought someone would have told you by now. I think you're travelling to Perth on Wednesday. Like, oh, like, fuzzy. Anyway, get in there and the team gets named to go over to Perth, and I was starting at 12 again. And we had a hissing backline that game. Like, I was the odd one out by a country mile.
Who was in there?
Like, you had Mitchell Drummond at 9, Mitch Hunt at 10. I was at 12, and I had Setter, Tamanivalu outside me. Manasseh and George Bridge on the wings, and Izzy Dagg at fullback.
Fuck.
And I was like, this 19-year-old playing with like some of the guys you look up to. Like, it was an unreal experience.
I remember watching that game too.
Mm.
You sound like a stalker, bro. But I remember watching that game too, and you definitely didn't look out of place, Jim.
Oh,
remember it?
Like, after what Rog said to me that game, like, I was just like, I got nothing to lose. Like,
just let loose.
Yeah, it's gonna be my last game because all the All Blacks are coming back. Like, may as well go. Just go put your best foot forward. And, like, yeah, just without any fear, just went and played and ended up having a half-decent game.
Do you reckon that's when you play the best?
Yeah.
Fuck, because I've noticed that too, bro. Like, whenever you just, like, let go of, like, the stress of, like,
it's almost
needing
like,
to perform.
Yeah,
and
the games you don't care about is when you play the best.
Yeah.
Which sounds stupid because, obviously, you care about, like, all the, especially the big games you're playing. Like, you care so much, but...
Yeah, but at the end of the day, like, you just remember, like, you're there... Because it's a game and you're trying to have fun. And
yeah.
When you play like that, fuck. You know when who's playing like that, eh? Because they're playing the best.
You talk to some of the boys, they play their best games hungover.
Yeah. Have you ever played hungover?
Nah, I haven't actually. I would be way too scared to drink before the night before a game.
What would you say to, like, a young buck who misses out on 20s, still trying to aspire, thinks that the world's over?
Well, that is not over, but... Obviously... I would have loved to make those teams. Anybody who's trying to crack it would love to be in that team, and it's a huge privilege to make that team. But just because you don't make it, that like there's still plenty of opportunity. Like you see, even people coming through in their mid-20s, just have a. It only takes like one good season, and like, yeah. At the end of the day, it's one person's opinion if you make a team. Well. Probably a bit more these days, but...
Not a whole lot, though, eh? Because at the end of the day, I guess it does slide to one man, really.
It's not the end of the world, though. Like, there's still plenty of opportunities.
Going back to what you sort of talked about, getting bought in, like, as an academy player and that, I remember, Beb, you talked to me about... you got called into, like, an ABs training or something? A while ago?
Yeah, that was when they were playing in Nelson, and they... I wasn't really called in.
But like you got told to come along and make up numbers.
Yeah, I was just a bit of a tackle back for a day. That's all.
It was
Andrew Goodman. He just asked. He must have been told by them or something. But it was me and Jake Norris and Thomas.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. I think it was maybe one more, but. Yeah, we're just tackle backs for the day, bro. But it's fucking
unreal. Eh?
Yeah, so unreal, bro.
Have you done that as well?
No, not with All Blacks.
Oh.
No, but the whole concept of
dogs. Well, another big part of what you've done down in Christchurch is you've completed a degree now, which is massive, so congrats, bro.
Thanks, bro.
How did you find that? And, like, are you happy you did it?
Yeah, I'm happy I did it. I know they always say have something outside of rugby going for you.
Yeah.
And I think it was more the lifestyle of going to uni while I was trying to crack rugby that that was appealing to me. Not out. Like you see boys who work and try cricket, you know, they go to work, they're up at like gymming at 6, 5 to get to work at 7 and
yeah.
Then straight after work, they're straight back to training, and it's like that. Like I commend people who do that because it must be so tough.
Fucking A.
So like having uni like with rugby, it was easy in terms of like you could chill, not be so like fatigued to going into trainings and
yeah.
But I also wanted to have something like in case like, rugby didn't work out. It is tough though, like especially when you're trying to crack teams and say if you make the what's Bunnings now that team, like you can't, well it'll be real tough to do a full semester of uni as well as
yeah
train a whole week and play on a sad day.
How do you usually run those seasons? Did you do like a one paper sort of thing?
I had two seasons in while I was at uni. Like my first 2 years I just tried to pump out as much as I could,
yeah.
Try to do whole semesters. And then when it started getting busy, I'd cut back to like one or two. I don't think I ever did one. I'd always go two minimum just because I wanted to
get it done,
pump it out. I remember when I tore my ACL, quite a big injury, I couldn't play rugby, so I ended up taking up another whole semester, which like helped me get through that because you see some boys, they just get stuck doing one paper and you got to do, 24? Yeah. And if you're doing one or two a year, like,
long time, eh?
It's a long time. I mean, I think my last semester, I was doing three papers during Bunnings just so I could finish it and not have to do another semester. Like, it's hard, but, like, you definitely have the time to do it if you want to.
Yeah, yeah. I remember when I was in Wellies and, you know, Reed Princep?
Yeah.
You know, has he finished yet? Yeah, yeah.
I think he just finished, eh?
Because I remember I was going down to uni once and I like seen him there and he was like, oh, sorry. And I was like, oh, what up to? Like, and he's like, oh, I'm just going to class. And I was like, what are you? He's like, oh, yeah, I'm studying law.
He's on to it.
And I was like, what? How long have you been doing that? And I swear he said something like, it was like a 7th or 8th year or something, bro.
A law degree is a lot longer than a commerce, which was one that I did.
So how long it must have taken him? Because that was like at least 4 years ago.
Pretty sure he just finished in the season just gone.
Bro, that is a long time, dude. To be dedicated to something like that outside of your main thing, like he's playing Super Rugby too. Like,
yeah.
You know, that's a big commitment, dude, to be able to stick to that.
Oh.
He's a weapon, eh?
Yeah, he is. He's a good man too. But yeah, to do a law, I couldn't imagine doing a law degree during it.
So what did you study?
Bachelor of Commerce and majored in Marketing.
Do you want to tell the story about how many lectures you went to?
Oh, I never went to lectures, bro. lived so far away because I used to... my first year, I obviously went to lectures when I was in the halls and first couple of years. But then once you get the drift of like uni, and don't quote me on this because I don't want to be the reason why you're failing if you do. But like, I know I work better. Like, if I go to a lecture, I just zone out anyway, like, I'm not present in a lecture and I just feel like I'm wasting my time where if I like catch up on it in my own time, like I feel like I'm just way more productive. I don't know, that's just what worked for me. But yeah, I only went out to uni if I had to go to tests or an exam or something.
Speaking of Reed, he was Maldives, eh? He played Maldives. Your first stint, you've spent 2 years back to back. You've had an opportunity to be in the, or at least in the,
yeah.
But you've been in the camp and in the squad. Mm. Do you remember the first time you got called up? And
yeah, I remember. What was it? 2020, end of 2020, and just come off the back of a minor 10 where I kind of got a lot more game time than previous years. Ended up. Started every game, which was as a rugby player. Like, just the consistency helps a lot.
It does, eh?
Yeah. Like,
if you're getting the consistent minutes.
Yeah, 100%. But I remember after that season, like, I got an email, like, from something to do with Maldives on, like, a long list of players saying you're being considered for it, pretty much just to keep training. Mm. So I, like, did that, stayed down in Christchurch a bit longer and kept training, and then still didn't know if I'd made the team, and the team's getting named. It was on, like, Sky Sport or the news or something. The team was getting named.
Mm.
And maybe, like, a couple of hours before I got named, I remember getting a phone call from Roger Randall, who's one of the coaches of it, and pretty much called and said, "Oh, I'm just calling to congratulate you. You're gonna make your debut with Quinny." And I was like, I was stoked there. I was like, called my dad straight away, like couldn't believe it. And and you talk to some of those boys in that team and how much that team means to them, like,
yeah,
where they come from. Like, it is above the All Blacks.
Yeah.
Like,
Oatsy, I remember hearing Oatsy saying that in an interview.
Yeah, he was the one that came to mind when I said that, Oatsy.
He said in his household, the Māori All Blacks was the pinnacle.
Yeah, it was the pinnacle. And so to get caught up for that and go into camp with, like, you know, players, like, big dogs as well, who you look up to and who carve at Super Rugby level, to rub shoulders off them and just be immersed in it for the week that it was. It was against Moana Pacifica.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was unreal and pretty proud moment for me and my family.
Dor Quinny as well. You guys went to school together, eh?
Yeah, so that was his debut as well, which was mean. It was unreal.
What about kit day, bro? Because a lot of people always ask about kit day and, like, when you get to go into teams like that.
Oh, like, we got heaps of kit. And, like, without sounding ungrateful, though, I don't think it's anything compared to what they do if they go overseas.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because it's, like, we're only there for a week for one game. Like, they're not just
going. Yeah, right, true, yeah, yeah.
Like, you get heaps of branded stuff. You get heaps of branded stuff in that. And, a couple pairs of boots, shoes, like. And that sense of it, like, it's exciting. Like, I think we turn up first day and your bag's there with all your stuff in it. And then you go grab your boots, shoes, and testing.
Speaking of boots, shout out to the Boot Perspective for also sponsoring this podcast. The guns, the goats with the boots, bro. Like, he sent me a pair of kicks last year, still rock them. Mention Hustlers, give him a message, mention Hustlers, and you get 10% off a pair of boots. So you get a pair of $300 kicks, that's $30 off, so you may as well try it out. So shout out to the Boot Perspective for jumping on board. Good little segue there, you like that one? I knew you'd bring up the boots when I talked about kit day. what's the when you made the team this year, and it was sort of like a late call, and you would tell us that story.
So the first year when I made it, there was heaps of injuries in the midfield. I think Nanky was out, and a few of the boys from the previous years have gone overseas. That's what kind of opened it up for me that first year. And then the second year, I originally didn't get named in the team, but, like, understandably, all the players were available, and it was only for the one game as well. It's not like it was a tour. But I Rod gave me a call to let me know that I hadn't been selected, and, like, I was all good with that.
Yeah.
Because this was straight after the Super Comp. He said, "Oh, but, like, you're on standby." And Donkin said the same thing to me in my one-on-one or end-of-year review kind of thing. Like, it's not because you perform, it's just players are back. And I was like, all good. He's like, "Oh, just be ready, you know." Didn't think much of it. Like, who actually gets called in that often?
Yeah, true.
Anyway, I had me and my partner had planned a week or 4 to 5 days down in Queenstown. Had planned everything, sorted everything, and booked all our hotels and whatnot. Head down to Queenstown, like, had a good first day. And then I remember on my second day, got a call from Donk, who's the Maldives coach. And he's like, "Oh no, I got a text from him." He's like, I think he might have said sup boy, never mind your, because he knew I was down in Queenstown. He's like, sup boy, never mind your trip down in Queenstown. Come and join us.
Oh, shit.
And I was like, I was stoked there. But then I was like, oh, how do I tell my partner this? Because we've still got 3 days left down in Queenstown.
You were there, right? You were like,
oh, we were out for
where
dinner.
Where were you?
Oh, no. We were out for dinner with some friends as well. And I was like, oh, no. And I think, oh, because the reason why, the All Blacks team had just got named. And
oh, Quinn.
Quinn got called up to the All Blacks, which was unreal.
Do you remember I messaged you?
Yeah, a few people messaged me like, oh, surely.
I was like, because you told me, I think the week before, you must have been back in the Mount the week before, and I caught up with you, maybe. And you were like, oh, no, I'm on standby, like, if anything happens. And I was like, oh, yo. And then I saw Quinn got named in All Blacks, so I messaged you straight away.
To be honest, like, I didn't even think of that, because I was just, once Quinn got named, I was so stoked for him, like.
You didn't think about, like...
Nah, it wasn't until after people started messaging me, and I was like, oh, yeah, like, obviously don't want to get my hopes up, but, like, he's a midfielder, I'm a midfielder, put two and two together, like, hopefully get the call up.
Yeah.
But, well, that's how that came about. So I had to... They booked me a flight, like, first thing in the morning. I had to leave Queenstown, like, 5 in the morning or something.
Fuck.
Had to leave my partner down there for the day. Like, she ended up booking flights back that arvo.
And, to Christchurch.
Yeah. We were lucky, though. We got reimbursed on, like, most of the stuff we had already booked.
So. Fuck, that's good.
Yeah. We didn't actually lose anything except a few more days in Queenstown. But a
few memes.
You'd take a Maldives jersey over there any day of the week.
100%, yeah. Nah, that's mean, bro. What when you mentioned Donk there, was the Bay ever in the picture when you re-signed this year? You re-signed this year, was it? Or last year?
Last year, I re-signed with Canterbury for 2 years.
Did they approach you, or?
He didn't approach me until, I think it was option, but he didn't message me about it until after
I'd already signed.
But I enjoy it down in Canterbury.
Yeah.
All like my close mates who I came through the academy system with, and
yeah,
they all play there. And like I said, the city itself, and my partner's down there as well. Like, it was a bit of a no-brainer at that stage, just to go back down there for that purpose.
Yeah, is it a bit of a dream though? To, because like your old man played for them,
yeah.
You know, like that's your home. You know, you grew up here.
Yeah,
so that's sort of like a bit of a thing you want to achieve at some point.
Yeah, for sure. I think. Eventually, I'd love to, if the opportunity and the timing of it all happened. I actually played a game for them at the start of this year.
That's right.
Bit of a loophole. When I was at the Chiefs, just to get game time, they had the, I'm not too sure what comp they call it, but all the...
Chiefs Cup, or Country Chiefs Cup or something.
Chiefs Cup. All the provinces play each other, and I remember they're like, oh, yeah, they'd like name the boys who can go back and play
in their
comp. And everyone who's like from here obviously goes plays for their province, but the boys who aren't, like, they kind of get dished out. And I remember being told, like, oh, yeah, you'll go play for Taranaki. And I was like, oh, because it was David Hill, he's a Bayman as well. I was like, Hilly, surely I can go play for Bay. And he's like, oh, yeah, I'll try to tee that up.
Oh, shmeen.
End up going back and playing for the Bay. And
Riv played for the Naki, eh?
Riv played for the Naki, yeah. But at that time, I didn't know a lot of the boys. Like, it was a lot of the young boys coming through who actually went hissing for the Bay this year. But, yeah, got a couple of games in the Bay colours, even though I wasn't signed with them. But,
oh, good.
No, it was pretty cool. Mum and Dad were pretty stoked about it.
Do you recently, you win unconditional on a house? Mate, congrats.
Just a disclosure, I'm taking no credit for this.
Bro, you're still your name's going to be on that. Obviously, you know, it's a bit of a longer process because new build and what's going to be next year sort of thing.
Yeah, it's not due to be finished at the end of next year, till the end of next year.
But run us through that process, bro. Like, how'd you find it?
It was a bit
growing up, boy, shit.
Yeah.
Buying your first home.
It's a bit of a funny one because... I remember my partner talking about it, like, oh, talking about the first home grant with that, like, what, 10 grand each?
Yeah.
Like, 1 week we were talking about it, and then she had a look, like, she's like a real productive, gets things done now kind of girl. And
yeah.
We started talking about it, and she had a look, and obviously there's that threshold of you got to buy under a certain price to be eligible for it, and there wasn't a whole lot around at that stage, and she's just like, well, we may as well try to get it now if the house prices are going to go up.
What's the threshold in Christchurch? Is it 550?
550 for a new one. And there wasn't a whole lot. And so we're like, we may as well try to get it now. And within a week, we had put offers in on the place that we went for. But that's what I mean. I didn't do a whole lot because I just left that all up with her. I just signed where I needed to sign and she just let me know what I needed to do. But she did, I'd say, 98% of the work.
But you would have been around it, like.
Oh yeah,
but it's a lot of work.
Yeah, like. I'd always ask, like, is there anything I can do? But like, this is not really a 2-person job. And I think the beauty of it, like, our solicitor was her mum's best friend, and her mum was a lawyer, which helped. I mean, not a lawyer, real estate agent, which helped a lot. In terms of like knowledge about.
Oh right, okay, whatnot. Yeah.
And so her mum's best friend was our solicitor, which like was obviously like dealing with her was professional, but still able to have like casual conversation with.
Yeah,
her.
Right, yeah.
And then our lawyer was someone she went to uni with as well, so it was all her connections and stuff which helped her out heaps. But I could tell she was under a lot of stress trying to sort it all.
Yeah, fuck, it looks stressful, man, and. It's not going to get any easier out of the way that houses are going at the moment.
Nah, no way. But yeah, like, yeah, we're unconditional at the moment, but I feel like there's still...
a few things in there, like we were talking about over breakfast the other day. Yeah,
there's still a few things that could essentially mean we don't get the house, yeah.
I mean, like, as humans, we always look at, like, every chance that something couldn't happen, or every little negative part of it, but... That's a big thing, bro. That's mean. And
it was pretty cool to have, take that step in terms of growing up.
Now, I've always got a place to crash and crush it, mean.
You always had one.
now you're at the Chiefs. Was this the first year that you got, like, oh, no, no, because you got named in the squad last year?
Yeah, it was a real late inclusion.
Yeah.
I remember... was at Maldives where Donk and Rog, who are our coaches for Maldives, are coaches of Chiefs as well. And I remember they pulled me aside, actually, and I was shitting myself. Like, had no idea what to expect because it was mid-camp, like, free time. And he's like, oh, can you meet us down here? And I was like, oh, yeah. I was like, fuck, are they about to tell me that I'm not going to be named in the team or something, that I'm not going to play?
Yeah.
But they explained the situation, said that there's possibility that we might be able to pick you up for the following season. And I think it came with the, not too sure if you saw it, but they were trying to get James O'Connor.
That's right. That's right. Yeah.
I'm not too sure what happened in the end, but obviously they didn't get that across the line and I ended up taking that spot, which was.
I remember we talked about it and we were like, if James O'Connor, yeah, just, it's all good. Just open it, it's fine. I remember we had a yarn about if James O'Connor was coming or not, and like that could mean that you might get a spot there. I remember us talking about
that. Yeah, I didn't really, hang my hopes on it because, like, obviously wasn't expecting anything. But and then it came out in all the news feeds and stuff that they're going after him. So I was like, oh, like if the news had got a hold of it, like surely they're close.
Yeah.
But then just before Christmas, I remember I got a call saying that that I'd be there for the year, which was
hissing,
yeah.
And now you're going into, like, you know, you probably, when did you sign that one?
So this one...
bit earlier?
Nah, it's a bit funny. So I remember going for my one-on-one, like, they pretty much just said, like, we can't offer you anything at this stage. Like,
right.
Happy with, like, obviously a good team, man. How you going? But we're just gonna keep it black and white. Like, we just cannot offer you anything at this stage. And I was just like, sweet. Like,
but you named in the squad and everything as well.
Yeah, but that comes from the passing of the brother Shawnee.
Right.
So they obviously were full, and they always told me that if they get the chance, that They'll want to get me back up here. And
right.
Yeah.
That's bittersweet, man. Shit.
Yeah. Like, obviously, if I could pick which one I'd rather have, like.
Yeah, but, I mean, that's out of your control. Was he like, being with him, being a midfielder down there last year, was he a big influence on you?
Oh, shit, yeah. It was a real rough time. It was hard because I was down in Christchurch and
yeah.
I guess the only other person that really knew him was, or well, was Tams through Maldives and whatnot. And I remember getting the news that morning and I just wasn't at training, eh? Like,
yeah.
Ran out of, we're about to go through a walkthrough, just ran out of it, needed some space. I think I had a good relationship as well. Like, I had heard a lot about him and whatnot, but it wasn't until my first year in Maldives he was my roommate for that week.
Shit.
And, like, honestly couldn't speak more highly of him. Like, he's that guy that's just, like, so nice to everyone. Like, works hard on the field and then just, like, the goodest family man off the field, like, yep. The goodest mate off the field. Like, he's the guy that'll go on, like, a three-day bender with you, but then on that Monday morning at 6 in the morning, he'll be there with his kids.
Yeah.
So, obviously, met him, roommate at Maldives, and then that year at Chiefs, like, in the midfield with him. And my first start was him at centre, and he was the captain of that game as well against the Blues. And I just think everyone that had the chance to meet Shawnee properly would have had a huge impact on him. Yeah,
it's fucking not good times, eh? And we all heard about that. Like, it's not something you want to hear, but I remember he used to talk a lot about how much he loved the, like, Chiefs environment and stuff like that. What have you found of the environment itself down at the Chiefs? Like, culture, I know, is very big there.
Yeah, like, the one year that I had there was obviously last year. Like, I don't know what it was before that. But speaking on the culture that was there, like, it's second to none. Like, the boys turn up day in, day out for each other. And, like, they came off that previous year where they lost every single game. Lost a few games at the start of this year, like, proper in the dumps. But boys stuck tight, like, good connections. And I think that just flowed onto the field and we just started feeling it and ended up making a Super Rugby Aotearoa final.
That was crazy. Yeah. It was the biggest comeback of doom, bro.
So, the culture's unreal. Like, all the big dogs, all the All Blacks, and the boys who've been there for ages are just so welcoming, and it doesn't feel like there's a hierarchy there. Just everyone's got a voice, and everyone is allowed to speak when they want to, and they just ask only that you be yourself, and
that's key.
Yeah,
that's key, bro. No, I love that. Do you have any sort of goals this year, on field, off field, that you want to achieve, like? Things that you're kind of, by the end of 2022, I kind of want to try and have achieved that?
Probably just, I guess it's, I do have goals. Like, pretty hard to talk about, but in terms of rugby, just like, not just turning up there just to take part, just actually compete and it's only going to help yourself get better. And then, well, that's right the way through from Super to Bunnings, because good competition down in Canterbury as well. And
but because, like, I mean, not only does that make yourself better, that everyone around you gets better, right? Because, like, I remember Wally's having a yarn with TJ. Have you, like, yarned to TJ before?
No, much? I've never had the privilege of talking to him,
bro. He's just a real good dude. You would have heard from heaps of the boys, eh? That he's a good fella. And he just always talks about that. And, bro, I couldn't speak more highly of the man, bro. Like, he'd sit me down and have conversations with me about off-field stuff, putting my happiness first, not the club, like, put whatever, you know. You know, you obviously knew that I decided to come back here instead of staying down there. I asked him for advice on that, and before I actually did it, and he was like, bro, do what makes you happy. Like, that's number one. Do what makes you and your family happy. We've got a couple questions here for you, bro.
Only two have come through,
but the first one has come from a very straight guy called Devin Potuawa. And he wants to know how big your piece is.
Someday I hope my mate grows up, eh? One day.
And the second one is, when will you put on the mighty Tipuki sports jersey again?
Oh, bro, I'd actually love to play for that club again. Might even try to push for it next year if they want me to come back. And
oh, yeah, because you'll be close to it.
Yeah, too, if I get the chance to, because I ended up playing club rugby last year with my – I went to play for Melville.
That's right, yeah.
Only because it was, like, the first time I got to play with my brother.
Yeah.
Which was pretty special, and I don't know, it's pretty priceless. Like,
yeah,
don't really want to play anywhere else. Other than that, like, when he got injured, I ended up flying back down to play for my club down
in
Christchurch.
Yeah.
Which was pretty cool, getting back down there and giving back to that club.
Yeah.
But, I'd love to go back and play for the Pirates.
Oh.
Oh, whoa.
Hey, bro, come play with us, man.
No way,
come
bro.
Come on, G. What have the Pirates done for you, bro?
What haven't they done? Nah, that was my club since I was four, I think. I started playing.
And your old man's a legend there? Like,
oh, some might say that. Nah, bro. He is. I think he played over 300 games with him.
Bro, that is massive.
Life member for that club. And the irony of that is when he was younger, his old man wouldn't let him play for any club except Rangiuru. So he played all his junior rugby with Rangiuru. Ended up playing 300 games for Poihipi Sports. But, yeah, played all my junior rugby there, bar my last year when I went out and played for
ED,
Eastern District.
Trader. I remember that team. Bev remembers that team. Traders, bro.
I just wanted to play off my
schoolmates. Oh, you had left, eh? Schoolmates.
Yeah, I'd gone by then.
Bro, I was the only one left for the mount.
Well, that's when Melny stacked the shit out of it, eh?
Oh, that was bullshit, bro. You guys had the most out-the-gate team.
Nah, but under-13s. We all went to school together. Like, half our team was from Pongakawa. The other half was from Pongaroa.
Yeah, true.
That was good fun, eh?
I'll still always remember that, though. Geez, thanks for your time. Thanks for jumping on, bro.
Yeah, my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Not the shortest driving from your hometown, so.
I'll hang around for a bit.
Yeah. Have a couple beers, chill out, Friday arvo.
Have to.
Mean. Shot, brother.
Yeah.
Shotty. Amen.